Good to see you all tonight. You feel like the Marines, the United States Marines? The few, the proud. It's good to see you tonight. Appreciate you being here. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father, thank you again for another opportunity. Thank you for these that have come out tonight. We ask your blessings upon this time. We pray that we might worship you in song, that we might hear from you in your word. Father, that you would just encourage our hearts and our souls. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Good evening. Let's stand if we're able and sing. Loud. Thank you, Lord, for your blessings of life. Lord, we just thank you for another opportunity, Lord, to be in your house tonight, Lord. And God, we pray for those that's on our prayer list, Lord, the ones that are in the hospitals, Lord, the nursing homes, the ones that are at home, Lord. Just be with them, Lord, and those that's lost loved ones, God, be with those families. Lord, as we go to the further scenes of the service, Lord, I just pray, God, that you bless the singing, Lord, and the preaching, God, and everything that we try to do, Lord, we want to give you the praise and honor and glory for everything. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. You may be seated.
Come, thou fount of every blessing, tune my heart to sing thy grace. Streams of mercy never ceasing, call for songs of loudest praise. Teach me some melodious sonnet, sung by flaming tongues above. Praise the mount I'm fixed upon it, mount of thy redeeming love. Here I raise mine Ebenezer, hither by me when a stranger wandering from the fold good to me.
Amen. Got a video.
Ah!
Take your Bibles and go to Esther chapter 3. Esther chapter 3. We're going to look at the entire third chapter. I'm not going to stand to read it because it's just going to kind of be a running commentary, but things I'd like to point out from this text. And if you just remember that throughout the book of Esther, if you just remember or keep in the back of your mind the providence of God, the sovereignty of God, how God works all things out. You know, Romans 8:28, we talked about that when we looked at the life of Joseph. We talked about that when we looked at the life of Ruth. Throughout Scripture, you find the sovereignty of God at work. Now, we see here tonight where evil desires are birthed. Now, that's not where evil begins. But we see where evil is birthed in the heart of Haman against the people of Israel, the Jewish people in particular. And we find where God is working. And even though we know that God is going to make all things right, and he is going to judge the wicked, it sometimes seems that evil prospers for a while. There are times that good people die at the hands of evil and wicked people. We see in this story that the Jewish people, through what happens here in the book of Esther, the Jewish people are preserved. I don't think I'm telling you, giving you a spoiler. I think you already know or should be familiar with the story of Esther and how it ends. But we look at it and we see that in this instance, the Jewish people were delivered. But if you look in the late 1930s and the 1940s, in what was then known as Nazi Germany, there were many who died. While they may not have been believers, there were Jews, but there were also Christians that died. And there are Christians even today who are being persecuted and killed. You go over to the African continent, and then some of the countries, Nigeria, Ethiopia, Somalia, and some of those others where there is a Muslim majority. Even if you go to India, you see that Christians are a very small minority, and churches are being burned, believers are being killed, and it seems as if evil is prevailing. But I said it seems as if, but evil will not prevail. The Lord will. And here in the book of Esther, chapter 3, we've gone through where King Ahasuerus got rid of Queen Vashti, had her put away. Some suggest that he had her executed. Some suggest that he had her just sent away into exile. I think that may be the more likely case, but I do not know that for certain. But Ahasuerus was king, and he had all these provinces. It says here in chapter 1, verse 1, that he reigned over 127 provinces from India to Ethiopia. Now, if you know anything about geography, and if not, you can look on Google Maps or Google Earth. From India to Ethiopia, you go across the Arabian Peninsula, and you go on to the African continent. So from the African continent across the Arabian Peninsula, over through Afghanistan, Iran, Iraq, over to India. I mean, he covered a large territory. He had an enormous empire, if you will. And you remember he had wanted to show Queen Vashti off. He was likely drunk when he did this, and she would not come before and parade before, and so they had her replaced, and they put this process in place, some of the king's advisors, and Esther was chosen to be the new queen. Esther, being a Jew, she had not revealed that she was a Jew because her cousin Mordecai, who had raised her after her parents' death, Mordecai instructed her not to reveal her heritage, that she was a Jew. Now, we will see later in the story that it doesn't appear to bother Ahasuerus that she's Jewish. But Ahasuerus was not known for making the best decisions. He had convinced his generals to go and to have a war against Greece and the Greek Empire, and he lost. They were defeated. He had had Queen Vashti put away. We see this, and in this part tonight in chapter 3, we see where he is convinced by Haman to institute a law. So let's begin looking at this. So after these things, King Ahasuerus promoted Haman. Now, he says, after these things, you go back up to chapter 2, you find where Mordecai discovered a plot against the king and revealed it to Esther to tell the king. And the king investigated, and the two eunuchs who had plotted to put King Ahasuerus to death, they were executed. And it was noted in the historical records what Mordecai had done. But while it was noted, it was forgotten. And after these things, that's what he's talking about. After these things, King Ahasuerus promoted Haman, the son of Hammedatha, the Agagite, and advanced him and set his seat above all the princes who were with him. So Haman is a character that found favor with King Ahasuerus. Now, again, I said King Ahasuerus was not known for making the best decisions. Probably was not the best judge of character either. But he selected Haman, and for whatever reason, Haman found favor with the king such that he got promoted and that he was above all the other princes who served with him. Now, when it says there, and he set his seat above all the other princes, I thought about what the book of Proverbs says in Proverbs chapter 25, verses 6 and 7. It says, "Do not exalt yourself in the presence of the king, and do not stand in the place of the great. For it is better that he say to you, 'Come up here,' than that you should be put lower in the presence of the prince whom your eyes have seen." Jesus repeats basically the same thing in Luke chapter 14, verses 7 through 11, when he said, "If you're invited to a feast, go sit in the lowest place. And that way, when the master of the feast comes in, sees you sitting down there at the end, perhaps he may call you up and to a higher seat. It may not be next to him, but he may call you up closer to where he's at. It's better that that occur than you try to get the best seat and that you be asked to move to the end to make way for another." Haman found favor with the king, and he was moved up above all the others. Verse 2 says, "And all the king's servants who were within the king's gate bowed and paid homage to Haman, for so the king had commanded concerning him. But Mordecai would not bow or pay homage." Mordecai said, "I'm not going to bow to Haman." Now, some would look at this and say, well, Mordecai brought what happens upon himself, because if he had just simply bowed, Haman never would have noticed. But Mordecai said, "I'm not going to bow before another." And Mordecai cared for the king because he revealed the plot against the king. And remember, these Jews that are there in Persia, they had been carried off, and now they are there. Some have been allowed to go back to the land of Israel, but he's still there with a number of Jews who are still there. Matter of fact, a great majority of the Jews that were departed did not come back. Okay, some did, and they began to repopulate, but a great majority stayed there, and they were scattered. So he's there, but yet he's not going to bow down before Haman. Then the king's servants who were within the king's gate said to Mordecai, "Why do you transgress the king's command?" Now it happened when they spoke to him daily, and he would not listen to them, that they told it to Haman, to see whether Mordecai's words would stand, for Mordecai had told them that he was a Jew. Now see, he had told Esther, "Do not reveal that you are a Jew." But he told these servants of the king, "I'm a Jew. I'm not going to bow before Haman." And it's a reminder, I'm reminded of the scene in Daniel chapter 3. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. Hananiah, Mishael, Azariah. That's their Hebrew names. And they, you remember King Nebuchadnezzar had made this great image. And when he had this great image made, that he said at the sound of the flute, the lyre, the harp, the musical instruments, whenever you hear the music, you're to bow down before this image. And Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah said, "We're not going to bow." I don't know where Daniel was at when this was taking place. I have no doubt that had Daniel been there, Daniel would not have bowed. But Daniel was likely not there. But Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah were. We know them as Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. However, they would not bow before the image, and Nebuchadnezzar has them brought in. And it tells us in Daniel chapter 3, verse 13, that Nebuchadnezzar was in a rage that they would not bow before his image. They defying him. And that is kind of like what Haman is. He was like King Nebuchadnezzar. And King Nebuchadnezzar, I believe that he cared for Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah because he gave them an opportunity. He said, now then, I understand that you will not bow down. But let me just say this, guys. If when you hear the music, if you'll just bow down, everything will be good. And they said to him, we're not going to bow. If you look, if you want to look over in Daniel chapter 3, you can just see this. In verse 13, the Nebuchadnezzar, in rage and fury, gave the command to bring Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. So they brought these men before the king. This is when he was told that they would not bow down. Nebuchadnezzar spoke, saying to them, is it true, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, that you do not serve my gods or worship the gold image which I have set up? Now, if you are ready at the time you hear the sound of the horn, flute, harp, lyre, and psaltery, and symphony with all kinds of music, and you fall down and worship the image which I have made, good. See, it wasn't about just bowing down, because there were those, there were other, perhaps other Jews that would have been there that said, look, we're not worshiping this image, but the king has said you got to bow down, and we just need to go along to get along. If we'll just go along, everything will be okay. Don't rock the boat. If you rock the boat, you're gonna make it harder on the rest of us. Do you not think that was perhaps the same conversation in Daniel 1 when Daniel, Hananiah, Azariah, Mishael would not eat the king's delicacies, but they ate vegetables and drank water? That some of the other Jews that were there said, look, guys, we're in a bad spot. We've been taken away captive, but we've got a good situation that's developing here, and you're about to mess it up. If you'll just eat from the king's table. And here, there were probably those that came to them and said, if you'll just bow down, but they would not bow down. And Nebuchadnezzar said, if you'll just bow down when you hear the music, fine. I'll overlook the fact that you would not bow down before. He's giving them another opportunity. He says, but if you do not worship, see, he said, this is worship. If you do not worship, you shall be cast immediately into the midst of a burning, fiery furnace. And who is the God who will deliver you from my hands? Who is your God? See, Sennacherib, king of Assyria, had basically said the same thing when he had surrounded Jerusalem and said, who is your God? What about all the gods of these other nations that I have conquered? What happened to their gods? Don't think your God will deliver you. And that's what Nebuchadnezzar is saying, these three. Who is your God that you think he will deliver you? Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego answered and said to the king, O Nebuchadnezzar, we have no need to answer you in this matter. If that is the case, our God whom we serve is able to deliver us from the burning fiery furnace, and he will deliver us from your hand, O king. But if not, let it be known to you, O king, that we do not serve your gods, nor will we worship the gold image which you have set up. They said, our God is able to deliver us. But if he does not deliver us through the fire, if we perish, we perish. Now that's going to be repeated by Queen Esther. If I perish, I perish. But you got to make your stand. And you've got to stand on the side of the Lord. You've got to stand because you are a child of the Lord, and you have to stand on his side. And so Haman is angry. And these servants, when they kept telling Mordecai, don't you know you're supposed to bow when Haman comes by, pay homage to him? I mean, he's just, the king has promoted him, and the king has decreed that you've got to do this. Mordecai said, no, I don't. And so these servants, they went and told Haman. They tried to get him to do it. Then they went and told Haman to see if Mordecai's words would stand. That's how the author records this. For Mordecai told them that he was a Jew. When Haman saw that Mordecai did not bow or pay him homage, Haman was filled with wrath. Daniel 3:13 says that Nebuchadnezzar was in a rage. Haman is, how dare you? What do you mean you won't bow to me? The king has decreed that all people are to bow to me. See, Haman was not familiar with Scripture, but he should have been. Had he been, he might would have known what Solomon had written in Proverbs 16:18. Pride goes before destruction and a haughty spirit before a fall. He thought he was somebody when he wasn't anybody. But because the king had promoted him, he got filled with pride. Paul would later tell us believers in Romans to not think more highly of ourselves than we ought to. It's when we begin to think highly of ourselves that we begin to get in trouble. We begin to elevate ourselves. And see, we need to do what John the Baptist said in John 3:30. He must increase, but I must decrease. We need to magnify Jesus. We need to lift him up. We need to put him out front and center and not ourselves. And Haman, because he would not bow down, he was filled with wrath. But he disdained to lay hands on Mordecai alone, for they had told him of the people of Mordecai. He had heard about, they told him about the Jewish people. And it doesn't tell us what all he told them. But it says that Haman wouldn't do that. And so instead, Haman sought to destroy all the Jews who were throughout the whole kingdom of Ahasuerus, the people of Mordecai. See, Haman had such an ego that when Mordecai would not bow to him, it was not sufficient to him to want to have Mordecai put to death. It says he wouldn't even lay hands on him. He wanted to have all the Jewish people annihilated. Adolf Hitler, he blamed the Jews for the condition of Germany. He said the Jews controlled all the money. The Jews, and this has been said for centuries about the Jewish people. And, they have a reputation for being tight, being frugal, some anyways. And Hitler blamed the Jews. And so he sought, he had the final solution. Anything that was not... they preferred the blonde, blue-eyed, Aryans. But matter of fact, the guy that I work with, a German guy that I work with when I was stationed in Germany, he was a civilian employee. Carl remembered, as a boy, he remembered Adolf Hitler. He said a lot of the older Germans will tell you that Hitler did a lot of good things for Germany as far as the Autobahn and the Volkswagens and such as that. But they said, what he did against the Jews, no, that was not good. We understand that. But see, a lot of the Germans tried to ignore what Hitler was doing to the Jews and to the Poles and to the Gypsies and to others that he was determined to just completely annihilate. He wanted to just kill them all, men, women, children. He employed them as slaves in his factories to make his ammunition and to make his weapons. And then when their usefulness was gone, put a bullet in their head or put them in the oven and gas them and cremate them. We see with Hamas in present day in the Gaza Strip, what is the cry of Hamas and Hezbollah? And it comes out of Iran. You hear this chant from the river to the sea. They're talking about from the Jordan River to the Mediterranean, that they want Israel gone. And what they mean is, we want them annihilated. And if you look at the Hamas's charter as an organization, that's what their charter says, is that Israel has no right, and the Jewish people have no right to exist. Why is it that they're not saying that about any other people group? It's the Jews that they say they don't have a right to exist. This hatred, and it goes back thousands of years against the Jewish people. And Haman here wants to have them all put to death. So, it says in verse 7, in the first month, which is the month of Nisan, in the 12th year of King Ahasuerus. So this was about 5 years after Esther had been made queen. Because in chapter 1, he's been there 3 years. We see in chapter 2, he's been king about 4 years had gone by. Now another, that's 7, and now another 5 years have gone by. It's about 12 years into his reign. Esther's now been queen for about 5 years. But Haman does not know that she's Jewish because she's never revealed it. He knows that Mordecai is. And so he says, in the 12th year of King Ahasuerus, they cast Pur, that is, the lot. They cast lots. It's like rolling dice. Drawing straws. You ever drew straws or drew sticks? You talking about drawing the short straw or drawing the short stick? You know what I'm talking about. It was a way to determine what they're going to do. And what are they throwing lots for? To see what month they're going to decree that all the Jews are to be killed. Now, look at this. They cast pure, that is, the lot before Haman to determine the day and the month until it fell on the 12th month, which is the month of Adar. Now, imagine this. Haman says, we're going to cast lots to find out, to determine when we're going to carry this edict out to annihilate, to wipe out these people. And the lot is rolled, and it comes up the 12th month. 12 months Haman has, he cast lots, and now here it is, it's decided. That's the sovereignty of God right there at work. Because what if the lot had come up 2 weeks? 2 months? But instead it came up 12 months, the end of the year. Haman had, now that gave him time to plan, it gave him time to prepare. But the Lord is working. God's sovereignty caused this to happen. So it came up that it's going to be 12 months. So then what does Haman do? Verse 8, then Haman said to King Ahasuerus, there is a certain people scattered and dispersed among the people in all the provinces of your kingdom. Their laws are different from all other peoples, and they do not keep the king's laws. He makes scurrilous allegations against the Jewish people. There's been no record of them not keeping the king's laws. There's been no record of them being troublemakers or people who were causing problems. But Haman doesn't let that deter him. He just makes the claim that they don't keep the king's laws. And really, what he's talking about is because Mordecai would not bow before him. And so he says, they do not keep the king's laws. Therefore, it is not fitting for the king to let them remain. So he goes in before the king and lies. That's not anything new. I don't care what your political persuasion is. If you look at our current president, it is clear he's not well. And listen, I feel sorry in a way that they keep putting him out there saying, oh, he's okay. He just had a bad night. No, I mean, we've been seeing this for several years now. I see this in my own mother. Jan was showing me a picture of my mother from October of 2022. She's sitting on the front porch there at, I'm having a Joe Biden moment. What's the name of the place where she's at? Cypress Pond. I'm having a Joe Biden moment. I can't remember. And I got, when you have these moments in the microphone. And there she is. There's a picture at Maxon. There's a picture of her and Maxon out there. And her hair is made up. She looks good. And she walked out there. And she wasn't using a walker then, I don't believe, because she broke her hip or fractured her hip in December of that year. This was in October. And yesterday we stopped by to see her. She slumped in her chair. She's still eating her lunch. It's not all eaten. We'll drop it. It won't always get there. During the middle of the day, there's not a sitter there with her. And we brought her a Frosty. And I asked her if she wanted me to put it in the freezer. And she said, no, I'll eat it now. Well, I took the top off of it, sat down there, and it sat there and began to melt. And I said, Mama, you going to eat your Frosty? Because it's melting. And conversating with her yesterday was pretty good. You've heard me say before, she won't carry the conversation, but she will respond. And yesterday was pretty good. But I've seen that look on her face that I've seen on our president's face. And we've been told, it's nothing. He's fine. Whether he runs or he doesn't, that's of no consequence to me. It really isn't. Because I'm going to tell you something. Jesus is on the throne. And come November 5th or 6th, whenever Election Day is, Jesus will still be on the throne then. Come January 1st, Jesus will still be on the throne, whether Donald Trump's president, whether Joe Biden's president, whether Kamala Harris, oh heaven help us, is president. It won't make no difference. Jesus will be on the throne. Now, I have my preferences, but that's not what this is about. And I'm just telling you, Haman was lying. And what you are seeing now is a media that was, they didn't want to believe what they were, what they were seeing, and they said it wasn't, and now they feel like they've been, they're all self-righteous, we've been lied to, and they're looking now, any little misstep that he makes. Well, Haman come and lied before King Ahasuerus about the Jewish people. He said, they're troublemakers. And so he has this, he comes to the king, he says, this, if it pleases the king, let a decree be written, verse 9, that they be destroyed. And I will pay 10,000 talents of silver into the hands of those who do the work to bring it into the king's treasuries. He said, I'm willing to pay 10,000 talents of silver. That's a lot of money. And he doesn't want them to be put into forced labor. He wants them killed, destroyed. So the king took his signet ring. It's like he takes his ring off his finger and he gives it. And see, with the king's ring, any decrees that were made, where they would seal the, roll the parchment up and seal it with wax, and they would take, the king would take his ring and impress it into that wax and seal it, and it had the king's seal on it. It said, this is official. He gave him his ring and said, do what you will, and put my ring upon it. And so he gave it to Haman, the son of Hammedatha, the Agagite, the enemy of the Jews. And the king said to Haman, the money and the people are given to you. Do with them as seems good to you. Again, Ahasuerus was not known for making wise choices. Then the king's scribes were called on the 13th day of the first month, and a decree was written according to all that Haman commanded to the king's satraps, to the governors who were over each province, to the officials of all people, to every province according to its script, and to every people in their language. Remember how large this empire is? There are multiple languages. And it's written in every language, and to every people in their language. In the name of King Ahasuerus, it was written and sealed with the king's signet ring. And the letters were sent by couriers into all the king's provinces to destroy, to kill, and to annihilate all the Jews, both young and old, little children and women, in one day, on the 13th day of the 12th month, which is the month of Adar, and to plunder their possessions. So there it is. He said, 12 months. Really 11, because they were in the first month. 11 more months, on the 13th day of the month, you are hereby decreed by the king to kill every Jew you see, man, woman, child, and to plunder their possessions. Kristallnacht in Germany in the late 30s, where they shattered the Jewish businesses, the windows, and destroyed them, and torched them, and burned them, and plundered and took. They didn't just burn up what they wanted. They took what they wanted and then burned, put them out of business and put them in the concentration camps. So that's what Haman is wanting to do. And a copy of the document was to be issued as law in every province, being published for all people, that they should be ready for that day. You may have heard that there was some movie put out, and I'm not promoting it at all, and I've not watched it. I read an article about it. It was a movie called, I think, The Purge. It was about where, for a 24-hour period, you could kill whoever for whatever reason, and nothing would be done. It was legal for 24 hours. The thesis is it was a way to rid the world of the weak. They're wanting to wipe out. They're wanting to purge the Jews, the Jewish people, completely. The couriers went out, it says in verse 15, hastened by the king's command, and the decree was proclaimed in Shushan, the citadel. So the king and Haman sat down to drink, but the city of Shushan was perplexed. Don't miss that statement. The city of Shushan was perplexed. I'm sure that in these other provinces, people were like, what? But it's official. This is the law. This is what we've got to do. This is what the king has decreed. But why? When it says the people were perplexed. That tells you that the Jewish people themselves, I'm not telling you that they were model citizens, but they were not troublemakers neither. And people wondered, what is this about? And it was because of the hatred of one man, Haman, and one king who couldn't make a good choice and allowed this. He just went along with what Haman told him. Now, next week, we'll look at chapter 4. But I want to just share with you some truths to remember about this, because when we look at this, there are times when the wicked do seem to prosper, when the wicked do seem to get away with what it is that they desire to do. In Psalm 146, verse 9, it says, "The Lord watches over the strangers. He relieves the fatherless and widow, but the way of the wicked he turns upside down." While it may seem that the Chinese government is prevailing against the church in China, I want you to know that the church in China is growing. In Nepal, believers are being persecuted as well as others. And it seems like they're going to win, but they're not going to win. Jesus said, "The gates of hell shall not prevail against his church." It didn't say that the individual church will remain open, but he did say his church, that the church, his body, that the gates of hell are not going to prevail against it. In Psalm 33, verses 10 through 12, the psalmist says there, "The Lord brings the counsel of the nations to nothing. He makes the plans of the peoples of no effect." Haman could make his plans, but God's in control. It says in verse 11, "The counsel of the Lord stands forever, the plans of his heart to all generations. Blessed is the nation whose God is the Lord, the people he has chosen as his own inheritance." And you go over into chapter 37, and I'm not going to read all of that, but he says here, this is what we need to be reminded of when we see people that plot and plan wicked things. See, already we're being told that we need to be silent in regard to abortion. You may have seen the woman that was arrested over in England because she was standing across the street from an abortion clinic and praying in her mind. She was not praying out loud. And a bobby, that's a British police officer, they went up to her and they asked her, "What are you doing?" She said, "I'm standing here." They asked her if she was praying. She said, "Not out loud." She said, "In my mind." They said, "You're not allowed to do that." She was set free by a judge. She was arrested. A judge set her free, and she has since been rearrested and set free again, because what they want to do is they want to intimidate people. It's interesting that just to see, but Psalm 37 says this, "Do not fret because of evildoers, nor be envious of the workers of iniquity, for they shall soon be cut down like the grass and wither as a green herb. Trust in the Lord and do good. Dwell in the land and feed on his faithfulness. Delight yourself also in the Lord, and he shall give you the desires of your heart. Commit your way to the Lord. Trust also in him, and he shall bring it to pass. He shall bring forth your righteousness as the light and your justice as the noonday. Rest in the Lord and wait patiently for him. Do not fret because of him who prospers in his way, because of the man who brings wicked schemes to pass. Cease from anger and forsake wrath. Do not fret, it only causes harm. For evildoers shall be cut off, but those who wait on the Lord, they shall inherit the earth. For yet a little while, and the wicked shall be no more. Indeed, you will look carefully for his place, but it shall be no more. But the meek shall inherit the earth and shall delight themselves in the abundance of peace." He says, don't fret because of wicked men. And you know, we read that and we have freedom right now, so it's not a big deal for us. But Aaron and Rebecca, I got their newsletter this week, Miss Donna, their email, and at the very top of their email it says, "Please do not forward or share without permission." to protect the identity of those where they are serving, of themselves and those where they are serving, because there are those who would seek to bring harm upon them if they knew what their ministry is. But don't fret. Proverbs 21:2 says this. Proverbs 21:12 says, "The righteous God wisely considers the house of the wicked, overthrowing the wicked for their wickedness." God's in control. In Proverbs 24, verses 19 and 20, he says this, "Do not fret because of evildoers, nor be envious of the wicked." That sound familiar? "For there will be no prospect for the evil man. The lamp of the wicked will be put out." And in Proverbs 16:18, which I quoted a few moments ago about Haman, it just says this, "Pride goes before destruction and the haughty spirit before a fall." There are those that say, you need to be quiet. You need to keep your faith to yourself. You need to keep it within your walls. Now, I want you to just think about that for a second. Those are telling us that we need to keep our faith private. It needs to be personal. It needs to be private. What they are promoting and what they are proposing and what they are putting forth, they're not adhering to what they say we ought to do. What are they doing? They're putting it out there. They're wanting you to accept what they're doing. They're wanting you to agree with it and to say that it's okay. And you just name the issue. But we serve the Lord and we answer to Him. And we must, in love, stand upon God's word, stand for the truth without shame, and say, "Lord, into your hands I commit myself. I'm yours. And Lord, if that means that I die in service to you, then so be it. But Lord, if I can live for you and bring glory, so be that." But when we look at Esther and what we're going to see next week and next couple of weeks, it's going to unwrap and unravel. It's going to unravel for Haman. And if you don't know the story, don't stick your hand up, because you ought to. Read the rest of the story. And be like Paul Harvey, Blaine, you're too young. You're not too young. And the rest of the story. Paul is still to come. Let's stand and pray and we'll be dismissed. Father, thank you for your sovereign care for your people. Lord, that doesn't mean that we don't ever experience harm, that we don't experience sickness, that we don't experience disease, that we don't experience death. Because, Lord, we can experience all those things, and yet you are still upon your throne, and you are still a good God. You're a holy God, a righteous God. And, Lord, we want to stand firm upon your word, but, Lord, we want to love those that are perishing. We want to care for the dying. We want to help them to see Jesus as their only hope, as the only hope for eternity. Lord, some people said, as I saw today, some people say that life is too short not to enjoy the time you have. But the response is that eternity is long to not be prepared for that. Lord, help us to live for you. Help us to be found faithful in service to you. Help us as we go forth into this week. And I pray this all in Jesus' name. Amen.